I'm Nate Lind, and I help people interested in buying or selling online businesses get the transaction done without the deal falling apart. If you're looking to buy or sell online businesses, then be sure to keep tuning in for more videos like this one. Be sure to subscribe and hit the bell for notifications about new videos and interviews. And introduce yourself in the comments. Are you a buyer or a seller? Enjoy the interview.
Hi, everybody. Nate Lind here. I have another broker from Website Closures, Brian Tumpain. He has been involved in the M&A space for a long time. Brian, I'd love for you to share us a little bit about your background, and we're going to get into anything and everything about due diligence.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Nate. Thanks for having me. Hi, everyone. Nice to meet you over the video here. So again, Brian Tumpain, been in M&A a long time. A lot of my career I spent actually in financial due diligence. I worked for a company called Grant Thornton for a long time. Worked on transactions both in the U.S. and actually spent a couple of years over in the U.K. So have helped buyers and sellers through a lot of transactions over the years. Did switch into the corporate world a couple years back and worked for the Walgreens company, helping them through some transactions on the M&A side, some big, some small, but have been around deals and M&A for a long time and particularly focused on due diligence. So happy to come here and talk to you guys today about that topic.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great place to start. Like, walk us through the due diligence process as it relates to let's start with like businesses under 5 million or under 5 million is probably good. That's where I think the majority of this has been, is, you know, we're seeing a lot of deals go through the SBA, for financing and that kind of stuff. So let's just start there.
Yeah, sure. And look, I mean, I'll make a blanket statement up front, and I'm sure you hear this all the time, but every deal is different, right? And I can't overstate that enough. So there isn't one template and one form you can use for everything, but you know, in general, you're right. There's a lot of sort of standard procedures you can follow and consistent themes you can look out for in terms of diligence. Diligence itself, I mean, it's really a general term, right? I mean, it doesn't mean anything in particular, and it can take a ton of different forms. I think most of the time people are thinking of financial diligence when they're, you know, thinking about diligence itself, but you can have IT diligence, tax diligence, human resource diligence, environmental diligence, legal, et cetera, right? So there's a thousand different avenues you can really go down in diligence. You know, on the smaller end, of course, I think you're going to be mostly focused on the financial side, you know, potentially some tax risks. You probably don't have huge staff, so there might not be that human resource risk and environmental risk and things like that. But you know, either way, again, when I think diligence, it's really broad. We'll probably spend more of our time talking about the financial side, because I think that's what probably most people, that's going to take place in every deal and probably where most people are concerned about getting their best look. But just kind of to set the stage, it is really broad. You know, in terms of the process, I would say, you know, really you got to start as a buyer and really outline and come up with a plan and come up with the things that are most concerning to you. I would recommend working with a professional. You know, I think there's a ton of good firms out there. Some of the firms I used to work for, some that we work with at Website Closures, there's many contacts we have, particularly if this is your first deal, right? I mean, if this is your first deal, I would say it's worth the investment. You can often find them for a fairly reasonable rate. And especially if it's an area you're not familiar with, you know, if you're an IT guy, but you don't know finance, it's worth kind of using a financial advisor, particularly again, that first time.
Is this something that you do, Brian? I know some of the other brokers do some advisory around specific aspects of the M&A process. Would you put yourself out there, or hold your shingle out there as someone to help a buyer with the due diligence process?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, again, it's my background. I did a lot of it. You know, I haven't at the present time, I'm more focused on the broker side, but happy to help. You know, certainly happy to help people through the process and advise as well. So absolutely no problem.
Okay, sorry, I totally derailed you. Let's step through the process. So from the buyer's perspective, walk us through the due diligence process, if best you can, A to Z or start to finish.
Yeah, no problem. So again, you know, I think as you think about it, and let's probably again more focused on the financial side here than some of those other areas I talked about, but really come up with those areas that are most critical and the sort of risk areas you see through your initial investigation of the company, through the materials that the brokers have sent to you, through what the seller has already shared with you. And I really think about diligence in kind of three ways, right? The first is a validation of what you've learned, what you've been told by the broker, what's in the sales materials. That's one. You know, the second is also to try to identify and expose risks that haven't been shared yet, or seeing things that haven't come to light. Of course, sellers are not going to be overly—they're not going to overly advertise or be, you know, overly open about every little risk that might be out there. So I think that's an important part of diligence, is to make sure you're exposing any of those risks that have not yet come to light. And the last kind of potentially an ancillary benefit or tangential benefit is really sort of a prep or a planning tool that you can use for when you take over that business, right? You know, help you think through your first 100 days or your first year. You know, what did you identify in diligence? How does that help you plan what you want to do when you take over as owner? Are there things you would change? Are there things you want to look out for? I think that's just sort of the three ways to think about diligence very broadly. And I guess in terms of a more specific process, you know, whether you're with an advisor or you're on your own, I mean, I think first step is, of course, come up with a plan, right? Again, outline what the risk areas are. Is there, you know, customer issues you want to look into, supplier issues you want to look into, trends you want to pay more attention to, whatever those things are, but come up with a real specific plan of what you want to look at and what you want to cover. You know, and then come up with how do you want to accomplish that? I mean, are you able to ask for specific data that they can use to support? It's all going to be through Q&A. You know, how's that going to happen? And of course, come up with a real timeline and a plan. I think, especially from a seller's perspective, the more organized you can be as a buyer, the better from the seller's eyes. Sellers are almost by definition extremely busy. You know, they're trying to run their business. They're trying to grow their business as it is. And so the actual process of M&A is extremely time consuming. It can be frustrating. It can be challenging to balance both of those things. And I think anybody who's been through M&As can understand that. So the more organized you can be, the more specific you can be about setting a timeline, setting a goal, you know, coming up with meeting cadences and those sorts of things will be helpful. Once you kind of have that basic plan, I think the next step is to come up with really a request list, a document request list, a question list that you're going to send across to your seller. You know, a lot of diligence can be answered through documents, through, you know, readily available documents, whether it's through kind of a QuickBooks environment or through information that's available through Amazon, whatever those things might be. I think you start with that question list, and hopefully the seller is prepared, right? Any good broker will hopefully be helping that seller get prepared. Hopefully you've got a data room set up, so there is some information there already that you can begin with. And once you have your request list set up, what I would say is, you know, bounce that request list against what's already available in the data room, and then look for information and send it across to the seller. Look for information to be sent as a starting point. I think, again, to respect the seller's time, to create a more efficient process, it's probably the first step to look through what's available, really dig into the data that's available, look at the financial statements, look at any other supporting documents that are out there. You know, I think showing that willingness as a buyer to dig in on your own, look at the data, and not expect the seller to hold your hand through the whole process, it'll go a long way, right? Again, trying to make this an efficient process, you want your questions answered, but at the same time, a seller's got a business to run, you know, trying to make it more efficient for them, I think makes the process better for everyone. So do your homework, spend your time, look at the data room, look at the information that's out there, you know, try to answer the questions you best you can. You're not going to answer everything, of course, and there will be a need for Q&A. So I think, you know, after the request list is out, you spend some time in the data room. Next step is really going to be Q&A with the buyer. And again, come prepared to that, right? Have answered what you can ahead of time. Have, you know, reference the documents that are already there in your discussions with the seller. Coming prepared will really put you in a better light with that seller. I don't know how many times you may have seen this, and I certainly have in the process in the past, where sellers get extremely frustrated by buyers that just show up, ask 100 questions, 50 of them, there's already an answer for in the data room, or you can tell that the buyer wasn't prepared. So just in terms of making it a good, clean, efficient process, be prepared, have real questions ready, and make sure you've done your homework the best you can ahead of time. And then after that, look, there's a point in time where you're going to come to a point where you have to make a decision. You may not get the right answer to every one of your questions. There may not be a specific piece of support that you're after. So at some point, you have to make a decision. Have you learned enough? Are you comfortable enough? And are you ready to move forward? Or do you want to, you know, go a different direction, back out, walk away, you know, change the structure of the deal? And that's the point of diligence, right? To make sure you can get to a comfort level to execute on that transaction. So I think that you eventually will come to a point where you've talked to the seller, you've looked at what's available, you'll reach a point where they can't really give you anything else. And that's where you got to make that decision. What do you want to do? There are, of course, a lot of ways to protect yourself from certain risks in the purchase agreement, indemnifications, holdbacks, earnouts, all these things that no one really likes to do, but they are there as an option. Again, you know, that other option is to walk away if that's the right approach for you. in terms of sort of finalizing the process, right? So I think that's the basic process. If you did use an advisor, it is almost certain they would issue a report, a report of their findings, a key findings report. Now, this serves a couple purposes. Of course, for you as the buyer, it's great information, it's great understanding and something to keep in your file. But oftentimes a lender or a third party investor is going, if you have equity investor partners or certainly a bank or a lender, they're going to need that document. They're going to want that document as part of their own diligence and their own underwriting process. So in terms of wrapping up that process, an advisor would likely send you a final report. If you're not using an advisor and doing it on your own, I would still recommend you do something like that. You sort of formally document your findings. It's probably worth having sort of a closing meeting with that seller to say, hey, look, here's all the things we asked. Here's the things that I'm still not sure about. You know, talk through what those are. Maybe something will have come to light in that final time. And then also talk through options, right? Say, hey, I'm not comfortable with this, but here's a way I think we can address it in the purchase agreement, et cetera. So I think in any event, whether you're using an advisor or not, it is still worth having that formality of closing it down. You know, coming up with a written report. It doesn't have to be 100 pages, but you know, a couple kind of pages to finalize and formalize your notes, I think, are important in terms of just closing that process down.
Got it. Are there any hot spots in the process you see where time and again expectations between buyers and sellers break down, or just some do's and don'ts, or words of encouragement or caution you may have about having seen this as many times as you have?
Yeah, of course. I mean, every deal almost undoubtedly will have some tension. You're talking about things that certainly the seller is very passionate about, and the buyer as well. You're making a significant investment, sometimes and often a life-changing investment. And so these are clearly emotional times. And so there's often tension, and that's pretty natural. And so I'd expect there to be some tension along the way. In terms of what drives those and what is a cause of some of that tension, I think it is the level of investigation that a buyer might want to go into. Now, of course, for a buyer, nothing's off the table. If you're a buyer, you're going to want to know everything down to the last detail. You're about to spend all this money and you want to make sure you know everything. And that's understandable, but I think you have to realize that it has to be balanced. You have to realize that you need to respect the seller's time and also understand that, look, no business is perfect. You're going to find issues. There's absolutely not one business out there that is perfect. And so you're going to find issues. And I think you just have to understand how to balance that. So I think what often creates this tension is an expectation on the buyer side that they need to have every last detail explained to them and understand every minute detail. And on a seller's perspective, they want to get through the deal. They understand the need for a buyer to learn this stuff, but I think they have a better sense of materiality and reason and understanding what's really relevant and what's not. So I think that is certainly a risk. I would say the other thing to be careful of, and I'm sure you've heard this term, but this sort of analysis paralysis, right? I mean, you see this with buyers quite often where they just get stuck because there are so many different things to look into and there's so much potential minutia out there, and you can get lost, right? Again, in any business, especially if you're trying to learn this business from soup to nuts in 10 to 30 days, it's hard to do. And so you have to really be balanced and have to understand. And again, I think going back to the original discussion, really starting with that outline, know what it is that you're concerned about, know what it is you're trying to accomplish, and then stick to that. And I think that will help sort of alleviate some of those concerns. If you have a balanced buyer who is critically thinking and is digging in, but also with some perspective, maybe that'll go a long way with the sellers and tends to alleviate a little bit of that tension that comes up.
Okay, so let's take a different perspective from this. So let's come at this now on the seller's side. So the seller's listed their business, they're getting, working with the broker, they're getting inquiries, getting to the point where now they've gone through a selection of LOIs or offers, that sort of stuff, and they've locked in. So we've got an LOI going. We're starting to move into that due diligence phase. What is some of the most commonly requested things? Like what should their checklist be like? What should they load that data room up with documentation wise from the get-go to, save in this back and forth, time that can string this out for, sometimes forever in the due diligence process.
Yeah, good question. I think, you know, again, with the of course, the caveat that all are different, but I think in any situation, you're going to want clean financials, consistent financials would help too. I mean, I know in a lot of cases, we're looking at growing companies that are new, that have such considerable and almost exponential growth. In some cases, it's hard to keep up with the financial side. That's often an afterthought. You see that all the time, where finance and accounting and some of the bookkeeping is an afterthought. And it's understandable. Again, you know, entrepreneurs are worried about selling their product, designing their product, all those sorts of things. But having a clean set of financials, having consistent financials, having something that yet a third party even prepares even better. But as long as you're able to take some time to have that clean set of data and clean set of financials is important. The consistency I touched on, but that is important too. It makes a buyer's life much easier if they can look at a set of financials. It's been prepared generally the same over the past year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever that is. That consistency and availability of nice, clean information is important. And it goes a long way. Beyond that, you know, again, it can go a number of different ways. And as a seller, I think you can really identify where your risk areas are too, right? You'll likely what you yourself consider risky, and of course a buyer is going to consider that to be a risk as well, or you know, an asset of the business, or you know, a sales point. So where you know you have your own identified risks or your own identified opportunities, I would try to come up with support for all those items, because again, buyers are smart. They know what you're trying to sell. They'll know where your risks are, so be prepared for that. Come up with what some kind of support to justify whether that risk is reasonable, or why that risk was created, or why that opportunity was created and you just haven't addressed it yet. You know, come up with any way you can prepare ahead of time to support those ideas and those concepts. You know, oftentimes we hear about customer concentration being an issue, or supplier concentration being an issue, or you know, just trends in margin being an issue. Hey, why is your margin going down? What is wrong? You know, what's happened with your pricing? What's happened with your product, whether it's your product cost, wherever that might be. So as a seller, you know where the questions are going to be. And the more time you can spend preparing for those specific questions ahead of time, the better. You know, the process is going to be easier for you because you've already got the answers to the questions that are coming. And again, you'll know where they're headed. So it'll just help you get there faster instead of having to kind of have them pull it out of you. And I think a lot of good brokers can help you through that as well. You know, in my career, when I first started in diligence, the idea and the concept of seller due diligence was really new. For the most part, and when I first going back to when I started, it was almost all buyer diligence. The seller would go through a broker, the broker would list the business, and then diligence would start after the LOI. Over time, you've really seen a shift in the diligence advisory market towards seller due diligence. I'm not necessarily recommending that would be necessary on a $5 million deal, but just as an indication of how the market has shifted, and especially when I was actually working over in the UK, it's a really common product over there where before you're getting ready for sale, you actually go through a formal diligence process with an advisor, clean up some of the items that a buyer is eventually going to find, prepare schedules in advance, prepare support in advance that's clean and user-friendly and ready to go. And it just saves so much time during that process. You know, you'll know this, and I know our founders at Website Closers have said this all the time. You know, deals break all the time, and often that breaks in diligence. And so the more prepared you can be in diligence, the more you can support those risks and again, be prepared for the questions that are going to come up with clean support, clean schedules. I think it goes a long way.
Yeah, I hear over and over again, some of the brokers talk about, you know, having the prepared financials, and it's kind of like, you know, showing up to prom and being in a dress, or showing up and you're still like in sweats from the gym. Like everyone else is in a dress. You need to get your business put into a dress and show up appropriately, show up and present yourself properly. If you don't, then you stand out like a sore thumb. And it's going to cause problems. No one's going to want to take you dancing. So,
yeah. And look, you might still be able to sell that business without your dress on, right? But it's going to take a lot longer. A lot of buyers are going to just discount you and throw you out right away. So it's going to take a lot longer to find the right buyer. It's going to be a much more painful diligence process because all the questions they're eventually going to ask are ones you could have preempted and you could have, you know, helped prevent or solve with some clean, supportable financials. So Yeah, it all comes down to being prepared. And again, as a seller, you know what they're going to ask, and a broker can help you understand and get ready for those things as well, just based on their experience. But the more prepared you can get ahead of time, the much smoother that process will go and much quicker. And obviously, as a seller, that's what you want, right? You want to get the close as quickly as you can.
Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, be sure to subscribe and tell me what you thought about it in the comments. Your comments encourage me to continue posting videos, and they give me ideas about what to post next. I read and reply to every single one. Also, if you own an online business and you're curious of how much it's worth, click the link below to get a free business valuation with a member of our team. Who knows? It may even be me you're talking to.